This is One-on-One with Jane Mitchell.
The faces of the Padres' future, Ben Davis, Gary Matthews Jr., and Matt Clement. Two seemed born to play, the other discovered as a diamond in the rough. They're stars on the rise and loving every minute of it.
This is the only place to play baseball. I mean, it's the only place.
While raw talent, skill, hard work, and a little luck are part of making it in baseball, stars are rarely born, they are developed. This is a trilogy of three young men plucked from amateur baseball fields to be homegrown in the Padres farm system. Three high Padres draft picks who seem destined to make it big in the bigs. Just to wear a big league uniform. Little kids while away their summers dreaming of it. But Matt Clement's odyssey to the major leagues was more a fluke than a fantasy. When he began his unexpected journey, he had pitched only 18 innings, just 18. Because Matt Clement's first love wasn't baseball, it was basketball.
I love baseball, but I love basketball so much.
Matthew Paul Clement, born August 12, 1974, is from Butler, Pennsylvania, a small town an hour north of Pittsburgh. His father, Paul, has managed the Kmart for 30 years. His mother, Lois, works for the county. He has an older sister, Marnie.
We're just average, normal people, middle-class people. And that's how he was raised, and it's all worked out pretty well.
He was self-motivated, an overachiever. He was a real good kid.
You know, taught me how to be disciplined and taught me how to be an honest person. And probably the one thing that sticks out is never give up.
His tenacity showed up early when, as a short and scrawny high school freshman, he rode the bench for his basketball team and vowed to himself things would change. He grew 5 inches over the summer to 6'1", which gave him an edge but no free pass playing for Coach Mark Jula, a strict disciplinarian.
It became a challenge to me that I'm going to show him I can do this. You know, to the point where maybe he thinks I can't do it, but I'm going to show him and I'm going to show all these other people that sat me on the bench.
And he did.
Matt Clement.
Matt Clement. How about Matt Clement?
Matt Clement does it with defense. Nice steal, then the dunk.
His goal with basketball was just to get a scholarship so his parents wouldn't have to pay for his education. He had no hopes to go pro.
I wasn't 6'6". I couldn't shoot the lights out all day. I wasn't a guy that, to play in the NBA, you have to have an extraordinary talent.
The college offers came in, his course set, or so it seemed. He knew he had a decent throwing arm, even asked his parents to have a baseball scouting service videotape him. But he didn't know anyone had really taken notice. He expected one college scout at a game to watch him pitch, but figured the pro scouts were there to watch a prospect on the other team.
Whether they were or weren't, I have no idea to this date, but when I came out of the game, Dad had 15 envelopes.
The next game,
walking off the field before I got on the bus, I got offered 6 full rides to go to college to play baseball.
All this 3 weeks before the 1993 June free agent draft.
Why would anybody want to draft me?
Kevin Towers, then with the Pittsburgh Pirates, knew why.
He was a basketball player, no real feel for anything than just a fastball. We couldn't let a local kid, escape us. And sure enough, the Padres snatched him up right in front of us.
And I said, you can offer me $1 million. I'm not signing today. I need the time to think what I'm doing.
Clement spent the summer playing Legion ball and deliberating with his parents and high school sweetheart, now fiance, Heather.
It was kind of, which way am I going? So he had to make the decision on either to go basketball, baseball, college.
He remembers the sincerity of former scouting director Reggie Waller.
We're going to give you the chance. We're going to give you the chance to struggle at the beginning, to learn what you do. We want to teach you how to pitch the right way.
That sealed the deal, and he reported to rookie ball in Peoria, Arizona in 1994. As for pressure being a third-round draft pick,
I never felt the pressure because I wasn't good at the beginning. I knew it, and the thing I think that was nice about it, I was humble enough to know that I wasn't any good. Nothing's ever come easy to me. It's even in the minors, It seemed like for me to move up, I had to do extra well.
Whatever it took, he turned a corner, named the Padres Minor League Pitcher of the Year in 97, and ranked by Baseball America as the club's number one prospect going into AAA Las Vegas in 98.
I needed that year of experience. I needed to get beat up a little bit in the PCL, and I needed to learn down there against guys like that are in the big leagues before that I knew about, that I've watched on TV, and to kind of get some of the awe out of facing those people.
He was put to the test with a September call-up, debuting with the first-place Padres in Colorado.
It was amazing how when I went into the game, everything that I was nervous about in the bullpen and thought about all season just left me.
Matt Clement picks up his first major league win.
But perhaps more significant was connecting with veteran Trevor Hoffman during his running regimen.
And he said, come on. So I ran with him and about ready to pass out at the end of the run. And real quickly, it opened my eyes up as to what you have to do to be at this level.
Spring training 1999. The Padres' top prospect again, Clement by all accounts, would be in the starting rotation for the defending National League champions.
Whatever happens, I'm not going to believe it till I'm there.
Pitcher, number 31, Matt Clement.
Oh! Wally Joyner fires to Clement, covering and throws. Uh-oh, this one is hit well, and I think that'll be it for Matt Clement.
While never a blowout, he took losses his first five games. Frustrated, he drew on advice veteran catcher Jim Leyritz gave him at camp.
What you want to do this year is, every start, you want to focus on getting better. Somewhere get better.
Slider, got him. Dugs, final game. Slider is in there. That's all for Bonnie as he takes a call third strike. Got him.
Matt Clement, just 25, is a little quiet, cordial, and confident.
I owe everything to the Lord, to why I'm here today.
And with marriage on the horizon, he's comfortable with how he'll handle the challenges of big league life.
If I have trouble with that, I'll look to my teammates and look to how I was brought up and look to my wife.
Matt Clement is the kid next door who loved the bounce of the basketball, but is grateful for his odyssey into the world of baseball, knowing how few ever have the chance.
I say that in my prayers every night. Thank you for giving me this opportunity.
While most kids crave being close to the game of baseball, some are literally born into it. Gary Matthews Jr.'s childhood playground was a big league clubhouse, and he's closer to achieving his lifelong goal of following in his father's footsteps.
I love the little things about the game. I used to love to go into the locker room and look at my dad's jersey, number 36, in his locker, and you know, to see his gloves and his spikes. But those are the things that I love.
Gary Matthews Jr. is heart and soul.
I started to write this song about you.
From his favorite music that harkens to his childhood to the way he plays the game.
Ball was hung up. Here comes Matthews. He takes the catcher out and scores! Good old hardball, just the way his dad used to play.
June 1999, his first call to be in the show.
You know, your life sort of flashes, you know, before you. I thought way back to when I was 4 years old and I told my mother that, you know, I wanted to play, you know, Major League Ball and this is what I wanted to do. And
in 1973, 23-year-old Gary Matthews was a big and fast outfielder with the San Francisco Giants, who emerged that season as the National League's Rookie of the Year. By the next year, the scoreboard during the August 25th game at Candlestick Park flashed an announcement of a different achievement. It said, the youngest Giant was born at 7:10 a.m. at Stanford Hospital. Mother Sandra doing fine. His name is Gary Matthews Jr.
Well, I was doomed from the beginning to be a baseball player.
But Gary was such a joy to raise. Very, you know, I had no problems with him. He was a very loving child.
When he was three, the strains of the game took a toll and his parents divorced.
You know, they always told me how much they loved me and how much they'd be there for me. And, And really, as a kid, that's all you need to hear.
He and his mother moved to a modest neighborhood in Los Angeles, where she and his grandparents encouraged his creative side through music, art museums, and drawing.
He made a little book, and it was about the baseball that could.
You know, she showed me there's more to life than just sports and baseball.
Still, his formative years were strongly influenced by spending summers with his father.
I did idolize my dad. You know, he was, for me, you know, the reason that I played the game, I wanted to be just like my dad and, you know, wanted to wear the number 36.
I was never the best player, so I knew I had to go out and work to become a better player. And I know that there's a dedication that has to be within your stomach. It has to be a burning desire.
An experience that had a profound effect on him came in 1984 when Gary was 10. He traveled with his father as the Cubs made their way to the National League Championship Series against the San Diego Padres.
I understood what was at stake going into the series and that they were going to have a chance to go to the World Series if they won. And
way back, going, it is gone! The Padres win it!
He remembers the somber Cubs clubhouse.
It was the first time in my life that I'd seen a grown man cry. When I realized what baseball was all about, and it was about winning. I never assumed, you know, it was going to be easy. And, you know, this game didn't really come that easy for me from the beginning.
He was strong at fielding, but not at hitting. In 1992, after playing 2 years at Granada Hills High School, he was drafted late in the 38th round by the Minnesota Twins, but passed to go to junior college in Sylmar. In 1993, the Padres drafted him in the 13th round, but he delayed to stay in school and play, having a breakout year, earning All-State and All-America honors.
Was sort of coming into my own and learning about switch hitting, and it was finally clicking for me.
Recalling the 1984 Cubs loss in San Diego.
I hated the Padres for years, and so for me to finally decide to sign with the Padres was just real funny to us. You know, we had a real laugh about it.
June of 94, step one in the minors, Spokane, Washington.
When I thought I knew, you know, what it took, you know, I really didn't. You realize that you have to take it a step further and that there's even more work to be done.
Matthews progressed to Clinton, Rancho Cucamonga, and Mobile for 1997 and 98, posting impressive multi-hit game streaks and rarely a defensive error. But he had his disappointments, including a wrist injury in 98.
I had so many expectations. You know, my goal was to be in the big leagues by the end of the year. And, you know, barring injury, you know, it was a strong possibility that could happen. You know, to have that all wiped out by injury was really disappointing for me.
He came back to be a key contributor as the Bears won the Southern League Championship. Driven to prove himself and to improve, he's played winter ball the last 3 years in Arizona, Australia, and Mexico. Seeing the world and watching the Padres play in the World Series on TV from Mexico.
Feeling like I was about a million miles away from the big leagues, and I remember thinking that, man, you know, I'll never get there.
And being exposed to poverty put things in perspective.
These kids never had an opportunity to have what I have, you know, and so I thought to myself that I had a lot to be thankful for.
Spring 1999. Baseball America ranked him as the Padres' number 5 prospect and best defensive outfielder. Then his hitting tear kicked in just as the big club was suffering injuries.
One ball, one strike to Gary Matthews Jr., who was recalled earlier today from Las Vegas, tonight making his major league debut.
I felt like a goofball, you know, because I couldn't wipe the smile off of my face.
Numero uno for Gary Matthews Jr., his first major league hit, a line drive to center field.
I was thinking, whew, you know, glad I got that out of the way.
His first taste lasted 2 weeks before being sent back down to Las Vegas.
Oh, I said, I'm so sorry. He says, Mom, don't be. He says, I opted for the roller coaster ride.
Still in a hitting groove with a boost of confidence.
You have to. You have to have that confidence. And even when you don't have it, you have to act like you have it.
Gary Matthews Jr., just 25, maybe a bit wiser than his years from growing up in the game. And now he's sharing some of what he's learned from his travels and his father with his three younger brothers.
You know, it makes it a lot easier to go out and play the game when you got.
He's a great older brother, a great role model.
The older brother pays for the CDs.
Yeah. Definitely have faith in my abilities and in God.
You can always depend on me.
And like the story he wrote about the baseball that could, he looks forward to being in the big leagues.
My game is right, and you know, I'll be there, and I don't have any doubt about that.
Coming up on One-on-One, From baby pictures to behind the big league plate, the Padres' new sensation, Ben Davis. Davis is soaking it all in, the California sunshine, the big league uniform, the standing ovations, the childhood dream come true.
There was nothing else I ever wanted to do. Nothing.
If ever there were a tale that should begin with Once Upon a Time, Ben Davis's story would be it. Cheryl and Bill Davis, both school teachers, live in the small town of Aston, Pennsylvania, just outside Philadelphia. Bill, who played some semi-pro ball, had a wish.
I always wanted Glenn, Ben, and Ken, the Davis boys. And my wife said, no, that's not going to happen.
They had Glenn, and 2 years later, March 10th, 1977, along came Mark Christopher, who they nicknamed Ben anyhow, and it stuck. When he was five, Ben was a little different than the other kids at Sunday Mass.
And they have their trucks or the little, you know, box car, you know, little cars, and I took my catcher's mitt.
He's sitting in Mass holding his catcher's mitt. Mm-hmm. It was so cute.
Baseball has always been a Davis family affair and Ben's goal since he declared it in the third grade.
People say, what do you want to be when you grow up? You know, you stand up in third grade class. I'm going to be a baseball player. There was no doubt in my mind.
But as good as he was in Little League, he did have doubts when he turned 13 and was a little scrawny for his age.
After one game, I went home to my dad and I was just crying. And I said, I don't think I can do this anymore. I said, everyone's bigger and stronger than me. I can't do it anymore. And he said, just stay with it, son. And he said, you'll be fine. We just kept working at it and working at it. But it was frustrating at that point because I didn't know if I was ever going to grow and get stronger, but fortunately I did.
While Ben did well at football, hockey, and basketball at Malvern Prep School, his brother was being eyed by major league teams.
I guess some of the scouts noticed the skinny kid behind the plate.
After his junior year, Ben was chosen to be on the U.S. Junior Olympic team in Canada, bringing home a silver medal. An excellent athlete and honor student, he signed with Miami for a college scholarship.
All right.
But then something started happening.
Scouts started calling, I thought, you know, why are they calling me so much?
Kevin Towers was the Padres' director of scouting at the time.
We felt when he got to the big leagues, he had a chance to be an impact type player because he's got power from both sides of the plate, tremendous throwing arm, intelligent kid with great aptitude.
Baseball America ranked him as the nation's second best prospect among draft-eligible high school and college players. So June 3rd, 1995, free agent draft day.
God bless you, man. We love
you. Hello?
Yes.
Wow.
All right.
Yeah!
He was the Padres' first-round draft pick, second overall. The next day, he and his parents were whisked to San Diego.
Meeting the players, walking to the big league clubhouse was kind of like, God, you know, I hope to be here someday.
But there would be dues to pay and lessons to learn down on the farm. First stop, Idaho Falls, Idaho. He not only made the Pioneer League All-Star team.
I loved it up there. I mean, that's my kind of country.
He turned a little bit cowboy and did plenty of fishing reminiscent of his childhood days. In 1996, he'd move up the ladder to single-A Rancho Cucamonga. But it wasn't easy.
Didn't seem like I had enough on the ball. Next year, I go back to the same league, and the same balls I thought I was hitting were going in the gaps and getting over the head.
He even played against his brother with the rival Dodgers farm system.
I just had to see Ben do well no matter what team he's on.
1998, he'd move up to double-A in Mobile, Alabama. While he struggled at first, his glove, gusto, and switch-hitting power at the plate kicked in to high gear. And the Mobile Bay Bears battled to win the Southern League Championship.
That year, and last summer, I'll never forget.
A contract incentive gave him his first taste of the major leagues that September, amid the Padres' race for the pennant.
And this will be Ben Davis' first major league at bat. He's a switch hitter up there left-handed against Greg Olson. Hard ground ball to the shortstop. Batista boots it.
And that gave me a sense of confidence, knowing that, hey, if I just keep playing my game, hopefully, I can play up here.
A year with the AAA Las Vegas Stars would have been fine in 99. After another rocky start, he turned a corner. His back got hot. And then, an unexpected twist of fate in June.
Leyritz started a swing, and the pitch rode in and hit him, and he is hurt.
General manager Kevin Towers gave Davis the nod.
And I went and I gave Rammer, Mike Ramsey, our manager, a hug, and I just started bawling. I just started crying, and I mean, that's everything that I've worked for my entire life was coming true at that moment. Mm-hmm. And I mean, the big leagues is the big leagues.
Ben Davis making his first major league start tonight.
So many daydreams I've had, you know, laying in bed and things like that. Just, I'm very happy to be here.
Suddenly, his someday had arrived.
There we go, numero uno for Ben Davis. Ruben Rivera is held at third, the bases are loaded. First major league hit for Ben Davis, and I'm sure the first of many.
I did not expect it. It's a lot to take at first. I mean, I get a hit, and you see 45,000 people on their feet, and I had goosebumps for the rest of the inning.
Then the umpire asked what took him so long to gear up.
I said I couldn't put my guards on. My hands were shaking so much, you know.
He has all the tools you like. The size is about 6'4", 215, huge hands, a cannon for a throwing arm, a switch hitter. Does Ben Davis not look like he just walked off a Wheaties box? I'd like to have his future.
Oh, my goodness.
That's not all. With his chiseled good looks, there's a buzz about Ben, enough to make him blush.
A lot of people think you're a stud. How do you respond to that?
Right now, to be honest with you, I mean, I thought about it a little bit, you know, but, you know, being out here in California, and the girls are a lot different out here than they are in Pennsylvania. I will say that. But right now, I'll be honest with you, I'm concentrating on my baseball.
And that's good.
Ben Davis, young, talented, with a big league salary and new celebrity, seems to have a good head on his shoulders.
You got to realize what you do off the field can very well affect what you do on the field.
And he seems to have a good heart.
For some reason, you know, people look up to sport, to athletes as role models and heroes, and hopefully I'll be able to give back to them, you know, because I've been given a lot.
He is grateful to the Padres organization for its guidance and to his parents for theirs.
I wouldn't be nowhere without them.
Without them, their support all the time, you know, there's no way my brother and I would ever be playing pro ball.
There are no guarantees in baseball, and certainly his once-upon-a-time story is still being written.
I have a lot of faith in God and what he has in store for me. And I think that, you know, as long as I put my trust in him, everything's going to be just fine.
Matt Clement, Gary Matthews Jr., and Ben Davis, homegrown in the Padres farm system, which is developing their talent.
So this is what you need to work on.
Allowing them their mistakes.
We're here for you, and it's your career, so let's get after it.
And nurturing their tender egos if or when they're sent back down.
Just go out there and remember all the good things that got you there, and believe in yourself, and you'll be back.
Clement's rookie curiosity helps his learning curve.
And sometimes I say, if I'm starting to annoy you, tell me.
He's just been like this sponge trying to soak up as much knowledge as he possibly could. And in time, he's going to be outstanding.
Ditto for Davis.
Let's take little baby steps with him because he's shown us an awful lot to get excited about.
Tony Gwynn expects Matthews to make it, partly because he's a second-generation ball player.
Besides all of that, you still got to have talent, you still got to have ability, you still got to have desire. And personally, I think he has that.
With the moniker of top prospects comes pressure, but also the need for patience.
Eventually, as they mature and get older, you know, they'll be more polished and mature major league players and have success.
As fun as it is to watch guys who are already established stars, it's just as much fun to watch raw talent, especially when it looks as though they have every chance of being the next big stars. I'm Jane Mitchell. See you next time on One on One.